everybody. We're so thankful for your presence. We have several who've been away, who are back with us after vacation, and several others who are normally with us but are gone because of vacation. So, as I say, almost every Sunday, look around to see who's not with us and make sure that you pray for them. If they're gone, that they will return safely. If they're sick or for whatever reason they're not with us, that they would get better and get to where they can be with us again. I want to remind you, as Brent did, as has been said the past several weeks, about the Gospel Crusade. It starts tonight at 7 o'clock at UCA in Conway at the Reynolds Performance Hall. It's very easy to get to if you're going down, what is that road? Starts with a D. No, not Doggy, the other one, the big
Dayboard.
One. Dayboard, that's the one. Take Dayboard, take a right at the UCA sign, right there on the left. You'll see a little sign that has DWJD, a little black sign. Follow that, it's right there on the left. Reynolds Performance Center. Starts at 7 o'clock. We're going to be leaving at 6. I know that's kind of early if you were hoping to ride with us. You're still welcome to, but I had to get there early to unlock the doors and to pay the nice man who overcharges to rent the facility and all of that. So I have just a few housekeeping things to do, but starting tomorrow through Friday, we'll be leaving here about 6:15, 6:20 or so. That'll be us there with enough time to fellowship. If you've never been to it, I cannot recommend it enough. It's going to be a minimum of 500, but we're expecting 6, 7, 8. It holds 1,200, but we'll just have to see how many we can get in there this year. But every year it's grown in size, so just maybe we'll have 1,200 people. Christians from all over Central Arkansas area gathered there. We had great singing and great preaching from preachers in this particular area. 6 preachers from the Central Arkansas region, speaking on a particular theme each year. The theme this year is those 4 letters, D-W-J-D. Now, that sounds similar to probably 4 letters you're familiar with in Christianity, or at least surrounding the Christian religion in America. Back when I was in elementary school in the 90s, there was a popular movement called WWJD, that's how it was. What Would Jesus Do? And it was on billboards, and there was like a wristband, there was like a lapel pin, there were speakers who wore t-shirts with it. It was everywhere. You could not get away from those 4 letters, that acrostic, What Would Jesus Do? The premise behind it is a good one. It's a simple one. It simply is this: a young person faced with some kind of a temptation or a difficulty or a particular choice in life, the metaphorical fork in the road, he will stop before making the rash decision, usually a wrong decision, and then ask himself, what would Jesus do here? And that's the motto that was carried around in the 90s and has now pretty much fizzled out. You don't really see it or hear about it too much, but it's entered our lexicon. We've heard that phrase. We know what it means, WWJD. Well, as we were thinking about the crusade this year, us who plan it every year to coordinate the gathering in each July, and we were thinking about what's a good theme, and it came up the idea, how about we do something that is targeted to young people? Well, naturally, that was one of the ideas that came up. We ended up not doing a theme targeting young people, but that idea stuck with us, and we thought, you know, in Christianity, we really shouldn't be asking, what would Jesus do? I mean, don't we know what Jesus did? Has he not left us literally his words of what he did? So instead of asking the question, I wonder what would Jesus do here, and then just leave it blank, we have said it should be the case for Christians to go around and preach the gospel of do what Jesus did, because we know what Jesus did. Maybe the world doesn't know, and it's our job as Christians, it's my job in particular as a preacher, but it is our job as children of God to go to those who are in darkness and to shine the light of Christ and show them this is what Jesus did. Now do what Jesus did. With that said, there are 6 speakers, as I mentioned, with 6 things that Jesus did that will be considered throughout the week. I cannot encourage you enough to participate, to come in fellowship with your brethren. Some of them you may not even know are your brethren. You'll see them there all week. But I understand that there are some who have to work, and they work late, and they're unable to get there. I know. I know how it is. If you can come, please come. But if you can't come, if you'll permit me, let's consider those 6 things we're going to be looking at in the macro this week. Consider them this morning in the micro. Just consider, in general, the 6 things that we're going to look at. 6 things that Jesus did do. So that as we go out into the world, even if we can't make our way to the gospel crusade, we go out into the world and you see someone doing something that is not right, or you find yourself tempted to do something that is not right, you don't have to ask, what would Jesus do? You know what Jesus did, and you just do what Jesus did. With that said, this morning, there are 6 points to consider. that we're going to look at as it relates to doing what Jesus did. What did Jesus do? Let's ask that question. What did Jesus do? Six things. First of all, Jesus preached unity. Second, Jesus overcame grief and sorrow. Third, Jesus demonstrated love. Fourth, Jesus was obedient. Fifth, Jesus endured temptation. And finally, Jesus, what did he do? Jesus picked up his cross. Let's consider those six things, and then the day will be yours until we meet again at 7 o'clock in Conway. First of all, what did Jesus do? We got to do what he did. What did he do? Number one, he did this. He preached unity. Listen to those three words again. He, who is he? He is not just anybody. He is Jesus Christ. He is the King of Kings. He is the man that I follow. He is the God that I serve. He is the one whose example has been left for me that if I just do what he did, I'll never be steered wrong. He is God, my guide, my master. The things that he did, I should do. Don't always. The things that he said, I should repeat, but I don't always. So what did he do? He preached, among many other things. He was a preacher. He wore a lot of hats. I was just thinking about this yesterday. I'm almost 30 years old. I'll turn 30 on August 26th, about 6 weeks away, counting down the doomsday clock until I hit 30. I'm not 30 yet, but I'm almost 30. My master, when he started preaching, when he started the most famous 3 years of his life, was 30 when he began it. So I've almost reached the age when my master started his mission to preach and to teach. But he had 30 years before that. And in that 30 years, in his 33 or so year life, he wore a lot of hats. He was a carpenter, was he not, early on, following in the footsteps, as was cultural in those days of his father, that being Joseph. He was a carpenter, following along with his dad as the world saw him. But then he became a teacher. And he would teach and he would instruct and he would draw people closer to God through his conversations that he would have. His very intimate, one-on-one, sometimes one on a small group, teaching sessions. But above all, the hat my master wore was preacher. When confronted by enemies, he preached to them. When approached by beloved friends, he preached to them. It didn't matter if it was a crowd of supporters or a throng of a mob ready to put him on a cross. My master was a preacher. He preached. What did he preach? Every single sermon he ever preached, every teaching lesson he ever gave, everything he ever did, it all led to this one thing he desired. He preached unity. Now look at a text to illustrate that. Look at Luke 5, 30 through 32. Luke 5, 30 through 32, where the Bible says, "But the scribes and Pharisees, the religious leaders of the day, spoke against Jesus' disciples, saying, 'Why do you,'" and they really mean Jesus, but they include the disciples, Luke 5, 31, "'Why do you eat with publicans and sinners, the outcasted ones of society?' And Jesus answering said unto them," quote, "'those that are whole don't need a physician. It's those that are sick. I came not to call the righteous to repentance, but sinners to repentance." Luke 5, 30 through 32. What is Jesus doing here? He's preaching unity. Doesn't seem like it, though, at first glance. It sounds like he's talking about who his mission is to reach, etc., but that's the message of unity. Now, when I say that, when I say he preached unity, probably you are thinking, oh, I know what he's going to talk about. He's going to mention John chapter 17, when Jesus, just before he was arrested, made that famous prayer to God. He said, among other things, "We are going to be one, me and you, Father, as we are one. I want the world who will believe on me to be one." Unified, unity, that's a great message. Yes, Jesus prayed about unity. But I said Jesus preached unity. Every sermon had that in the subtext, had that in the background, and it's here, right here on display. What's happening in Luke 5? Jesus is sitting down for a meal. Man's got to eat. He's got to have friends that he eats with. He has to people that he associates with. People that, as he did in his life, he hopes to draw closer to God. That's his mission. He'll ultimately do that with the cross, but while he's alive, his mission was to reach out to people, to talk to people, to sit and eat with people. And it just so happened on this occasion, the people he was eating with were the outcasted ones. Who outcasted them? Not God. The publicans and sinners were outcasted by the Pharisees and scribes. The so-called leaders said, "It's okay if you commit this sin or that sin, but this kind of sin, whoo, that's the kind of sin we don't associate with. We got to get rid of those people, kick them out, don't fellowship with them. They don't have a problem with Jesus associating. associates with just the every now and then sinner, but it's those who have fallen into disrepair as the world sees them, fallen into disregard as the world sees them. Those have nothing to do with. Shame on you, Jesus, for sitting down and eating with publicans and sinners. But that's what my master does for a living. He sat down and ate with them. Now think about this. What is his message as he rebukes them for what they said? Those that are healthy don't need a doctor. Who needs a doctor? Those that are sick. What good is a doctor if he says, ooh, sick people, no thank you. He never would heal anybody. My master understands I'm the only one who can do the healing. I need to go and associate myself with those people who are very sick. And what does he do? He brings them to God. Who is already with God? Those that are righteous, who don't need a doctor, but those that are sick, they need a doctor. When they get the good physician, they also go to God. And so what are they together? Those that are righteous and those that are unrighteous become righteous, and together they are unified. Now, do what Jesus did. And that means you might have to associate yourself with some untoward people. You might have to find yourself smiling and shaking hands with and being friendly with someone that the world, maybe even religious leaders, would say, you can't associate with those people. These kinds of sinners, they're okay, but that kind of sinner, that's a super sinner. We can't associate with that kind of sinner. Don't be seen with them, or people will think that you agree with them. Those that are whole don't need the doctor, but the sick do. Associate with them. Find unity. How do you find unity? When you bring them to God. You're with God, right? Bring them to God. What will you be? Unified. That means we might have to invite some people to sit in our pews, to eat our fellowship meals that the world might shock at the sight of. We might have to send some liars back there to eat with. We might have to eat with some adulterers. We might have to smile and shake hands with a homosexual. Oh, we can't associate with them. I don't want to be seen shaking hands with them. My master ate with them. You want unity? Bring them to God. You're not bringing them to God if you're shunning them. He preached unity. Now do what Jesus did. Number two, what did Jesus do? He overcame grief and sorrow. Notice, I didn't say he dealt with grief and sorrow. We've all been there. I didn't say he faced grief and sorrow. Did that. Been there, done that. I said Jesus, not wading through, not waiting it out. No, Jesus overcame. I didn't say rose above grief and sorrow. That would imply he has got some special tricks that he's got that I haven't got. No, Jesus did something that I can do. He overcame grief and sorrow. Aren't you thankful that Jesus is your perfect example? That you can follow. You got his words right here. And you got the words written about him right here that you can read and just say, if I just do what he did, then I'll be all right. Why doesn't the world do that? Why don't we, the church, do that? Just do what he did. You know why? Because it requires thinking, and Satan's very good about clouding our thoughts. He will throw darts, he will cast a net, he will put a blank sheet over our mind, and he will, by the things in the world, distract us from what Jesus did. For example, a tempted mind. It is one that is distracted from godliness by worldly desires. For example, anxious mind. Is one distracted from godliness by worldly pleasures or worldly distractions, worldly problems. A grief-stricken mind is one, as we're talking about right now, that is distracted from godliness by worldly sorrow. Have you ever experienced a tragedy? Let's just use the big common one, a loss of a loved one, a close loved one. And you look back on it years later and you think, I can remember this day, I can remember that face, I can remember this event or that moment, but overall it just feels like a blur, right? You know, you remember this or that, and you don't even think about the fact that hundreds of people through the course of that grief period were coming to you saying, I'm praying for you, I'm thinking about you, I'm really sorry for your loss. You don't remember their faces, you don't remember exactly what they said, it's just a wash, it's just a blur because it's just a haze up here. Do you think the devil is saying, oh man, feel bad for them, I'll give them a couple of weeks and then I'll get back at them? No, he will use that against you. You can, however, overcome grief and sorrow. My master did, and he paved the way. Look at John 11, 32 through 35 to start with. Follow the example of Jesus. John 11, 32 through 35. John writes, then when Mary was come where Jesus was and saw him, she fell down at his feet, saying to him, Lord, if thou hadst been here, my brother would not have died. When Jesus therefore saw her weeping, and the Jews also weeping which came with her, he, my Bible says, groaned in the spirit. Literally, he had inner pain. His inner thoughts ached and was troubled, and said, verse 35, where have you laid him? They said to him, Lord, come and see. Or here's verse 35. Sometime in between walking to see where his friend Lazarus was laid and arriving to see where his friend Lazarus was laid, then John says, Jesus wept. When he suffered the loss of a friend, unlike what so many people do, he does not distance himself from God. He didn't use the expression that I've heard way too many times, the Lord took my friend. God took my loved one. God is not in the taking business. He's in the saving business. Satan, however, is more than happy to take that loved one from you and to kill that loved one, take that loved one, because it is by sin that death is in the world. Who's responsible for sin? Not God, but man, and Satan who tempted man. Don't blame God when your loved one dies. Blame Satan when your loved one dies. And if that loved one's a Christian, don't say God took them. I promise you, that is no comfort to the loved one if you're trying to offer friendly words of advice. Don't say God took that person. That person left this world. They went home, if you want to say that. But God is not yanking people away, because that sounds like I had them, God took them. God's now my enemy. He's my antagonizer. He's trying to make me feel bad. That's not right. God doesn't separate himself, distance himself from God. When this happens, instead, he drew closer to God. What does he do in John 11, 41 and 42? He prays to God. He's given me the example of what to do to overcome grief. He feels emotional pain, but what does he do? He does something about it. Now, you might say, where's the application here? Because the thing that Jesus did about it was to raise his friend. I can't exactly do that. But Jesus gives you the application here. Look at John 11, 39 and 40. John 11, 39 and 40. Jesus said, take away the stone. Martha, the sister of him that was dead, said to him, Lord, by this time he stinks. He's been in the grave for so long, he already started to smell. He's been dead 4 days. Jesus said to her, said I not unto thee, that if thou would believe, that you could see the glory of God? And of course, he's about to say, Lazarus, come forth and fulfill exactly. Show that he is exactly who he claims to be, the one in whom to believe, the one in whom can do what? Raise my loved one from the dead. I lose my loved one, my Christian friend, my Christian family member from death. I am grief-stricken, but I can overcome it. How? Jesus Christ, the same one who rose Lazarus, will raise my friend. Maybe not in this life, but when he returns, the dead will rise and we will be together forever. We just have to wait a little while. Mary had to wait a little while before she saw Lazarus. I can wait a little while before I see my dead Christian loved ones. How do we overcome grief and sorrow? Do what Jesus did. He wept over his friend's death, showing it's okay to mourn. He prays to God, showing what to do with our mourning. Give it to the Father. He rose Lazarus, showing us his power. And if we just believe in him, have faith in him, trust in him, he will help us overcome. Are you suffering or hurting? I don't know your pain. Do what Jesus did, and I know he can take care of you. Number three, what did Jesus do? He demonstrated love. Look at John 13. 34 and 35. We read this text a couple of weeks ago. Look at it again. John 13, 34. A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another, as I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this shall all men know that you're my disciples, if you have love one to another. Now, as I said, we looked at this in detail a couple of weeks ago. We're not rehashing that, but I want to remind us that this word love, or rather the word new, in the kind of love we have, the new commandment is new. The Greek word is kainos, which means a new quality. To take an old thing and to put a new spin on it. It's not a new commandment to love someone. But it is to love someone as Jesus loved us that gives it a new kind of shine. Gives it a new kind of quality. There's nothing hard about loving people that love you. In fact, love you too is as easy to say as I love you. You just have to slap a two on the end of it. It's easy to love someone who loves you. There's nothing challenging about not hating someone who hates us or that doesn't hate us, being neutral with people. Nothing challenging about that. The challenge comes when we're supposed to love people regardless of who they are. Whether they love us or hate us, it stays the same. That's challenging. Now, it's easy to say. It's easy sometimes to think. It's hard, very hard to do constantly. You ever been cut off on the interstate? It's hard to love constantly. But isn't that the golden rule? Listen to him again, Matthew 7:12, and listen carefully to what he says. Therefore, whatsoever you would that men do to you, do to them. Because that's the law of the prophets. Whatever you would wish people to treat you in the doing of them, however you want people to do to you, go and do to them. But they're not doing anything to me at all. But you would wish they'd do good to you, right? Yeah. So go do to them. But they're doing bad to me. But you would wish them to do good to you, right? Yeah. So go do good to them. You see, there's a lot of religions that have a lot of different spins on this golden rule. The Buddhists, the great home, peace-loving Buddhists, they have, if you don't want them doing bad to you, don't do bad to them. Well, that's fine. That's lazy. That's not me doing anything. I don't want you doing bad to me, so I won't do anything. I'll just sit here with my legs crossed and meditate. That doesn't help anybody. Jesus says, go be a doer. You want them to do good to you, even if they've got a gun and they're running your way, do good to them. Why? That's what loving people do. Now, did Jesus say that? Did Jesus think that? Did Jesus do that? Yes, and then he did one better. He demonstrated it. He didn't just do it and walk away. He did it and said, now you come do likewise. He demonstrated love when he went to the cross for his enemies. Would you want me to die for you? If I could, in dying for you, save your soul, take away your humility, take away your thinking, oh, I don't want you to have to die for me. If my dying for you could save your soul, would you want me to? Not would you wish you were another way. No. Just would you want me to? Yes, you would. If you could die to save me, would I want you to do that? I would want you to do that. I want Jesus to die for me. He's the only one who can, and he did. He demonstrated love. Do what Jesus did. Go do. What did Jesus do? Number four. Almost done. He was obedient. In the Garden of Gethsemane, he uttered a beautiful prayer. Really, that's the way the song goes. I don't know what's beautiful about it. He said, not my will, but thine be done. And he cries that in groaning agony. I don't see beauty. I see pain. And maybe you think pain is beautiful. Maybe the whole picture of it is what's beautiful. That's fine. But when I see it, I'm brokenhearted. Not as much as he was, but I don't see beauty in the prayer of Gethsemane. What I see is a man who is begging his Father in heaven for some other way. He's not trying to weasel his way out of obedience. He's simply saying, if there's another way I can be obedient, then this way, give me that alternate route. But there was no other way. And though he prayed, Father, in Matthew, let this cup pass. And though he prayed to God in Mark, Father, remove this cup. And though he prayed to Father in Luke, Father, take this cup away from me. He still got the same answer every time. What was the answer? No, this is the only way. And then he did something bigger than that. He got up. Luke 22:45. There was no. He doesn't run away. He doesn't stay in prayer and keep begging. He gets up because he is obedient. Judas and his band of criminals, if we can call them what they are, coming to arrest him to start the whole chain in motion. But he got up and took it. Why? Because he was obedient. And because he was obedient, he now dwells in eternal majesty with God. Do you want to dwell in eternal majesty with God? Do what Jesus did. Be obedient. What did he do? Number five, he endured temptation. His enduring temptation is one of the hallmarks of his messiahship. If he doesn't endure temptation, if just one little time, he gives in. Just one time, says a bad thing. One time, does the wrong thing. It's all shot. We all are doomed. We're wasting our time here. Wasting our time this whole week at the crusade coming up. But he didn't give in. He endured. Hebrews 4:15. Because he endured, he gave me the recipe so that I can endure. Though I've already messed up. I've already made my mistakes. All will sin at some point if you're alive long enough. But he gave me the template to endure. Matthew 4:1-11. Turn these stones into bread, Satan said. It is written, man shall not live by bread alone. Though he is tempted to give in to fleshly desires, to satisfy his hunger, he does not. He says, Satan does to him, why don't you cast yourself down? It's written, Satan said, the angels will protect you. But God says, Jesus says, it's written, man shall not tempt the Lord thy God. God is the one you serve. I don't need to be tempting him. He's my God. Even though he could have jumped off a cliff and he could have been protected by the angels, he doesn't tempt God. Satan says, why don't you just fall down and worship me? Just one time, only once, and then you can have all the kingdoms of the world to rule like a tyrant, like a despot, like a cruel tyrant. You could rule over the world. Now, I doubt Satan will live up to his bargain, but that was the deal. And he says, Jesus does. It's written, the Lord is God. Him only shall you serve. It is written, it is written, it is written. You notice he doesn't use any supernatural power. He doesn't use his abilities as the Son of God to avoid the temptation. In fact, it's his being God that Satan primarily uses against him. You made the world. Fall down to me and you can worship it. You are God. God's angels will protect you until you judge. You're God. You can make these stones bread. He doesn't use his powers as God. That's what he's being tempted with. He defeated Satan as a man. So can I do what Jesus did. Use the word of God. Know it, think it, believe it, preach it, do it. And you can endure temptation. And if you don't, if you mess up, you've got the one who never did give up. And he can help you home. Last point and then we're done. What did Jesus do? He picked up his cross. As we close, listen to the Lord's invitation. It's not, come unto me all ye that labor. No, that's the nice one. I mean the other invitation. Matthew 16:24. Jesus says to his disciples, if anyone will come after me, let him deny himself. Let him take up his cross. Let him follow me. Do you want to come after me? I'm inviting you to come after me. What must I do, Lord? Let the one who wants to come after me, let him deny himself. You got to love me more than the world, Jesus says. Let him take up his cross. You got to love me enough to die. You give up your life. And let him follow me. You got to love me enough to stick with it. Because you're going to say in the beginning, Jesus says to us, oh, I'll follow you. Look at me, I got my cross. I'm ready to go, Jesus. It's really easy at the starting line to be all amped up, to be ready to go, to be ready to run the race. And then you get 10 feet out. Whew, this is hard. And then you start slowing down. You start turning uphill. It's hard. You're dragging that cross. And you think, you know what? I don't really need this. Some of us Christians have said that. I don't need this. I'm just going to let this cross go. I'm going to go back to the world. I'm going to turn and go downhill where it's easy. He knows that. That's why he adds to that, follow me. Because if you follow him, what's your end result? Matthew 16:25. Whoever will save his life, I'm done with this, I'm going back to the world, will end up losing his life. You only think you're saving your life. But whoever will lose his life, take your cross to the top of the hill, plant it there, be nailed to it, and die for him, you'll find life forever and ever. Because what did Jesus do? He picked up his cross. He went up the hill, though it was hard, and he did it. He died for me. If necessary, do what Jesus did. It may never be necessary for you to die by this in a physical, painful kind of death for Jesus. You may never have to. We live in America, may never come up. But you will have to die with Jesus if you want to see him forever. Romans chapter 6. Be baptized, put to death your sins, and become part of Jesus' physical, spiritual body, his church. Listen, as we close, Jesus was baptized because God commanded it. Matthew chapter 3. He still commands it. Mark 16:16. So why don't you obey as Jesus tells you to? Will you do that? Will you put on Christ? Be faithful to him forever? If so, heaven is yours, waiting for you. If we can help you, let us know how right now as we stand and sing.